Why did you leave Glasgow in the first place?
Because I'd daft didn't like it, threw it out.
Who?
My dad. So I got through it to come down here.
Why did you choose to come to London?
My sister stays down here. So I thought she'd a flat, but she's not got one.
What else did you expect to find?
A job in the borough. It's better than Glasgow. It's better than Glasgow now.
Have you got a job now?
No.
Why not?
Because I've been looking, but I can't get any. It suits me. So.
Yeah. So what happened when you first arrived in at Euston?
I didn't know where to go. I had to ask people. First we'd take you to Stilton Mountain. Somebody told you it was a 73. So I took it.
How much money did you have when you arrived?
£2.
Well, what happened when you got to Dalston? You were looking for your sister.
And then I found her. She was still in a battered wife's refuge, so I couldn't go and stay with her. She took us around to the police station.
You couldn't find her?
No, because I didn't arrive down here tonight. 10 o'clock at night.
And what happened at the police station? How long did you stay there?
2 nights.
And then?
I was told just to go to the best end. Night shelter or let us stay. So I went, stayed there for a few days and I got...
What did you feel like when you find yourself alone in London?
I'm dead scared.
Where are you staying at the moment?
In a hostel. I'm going to put it in 6 months' time, or 4 months, depends.
What do you expect to do then?
I hope to have a flat bed in, or a bed set.
Do you know how much money it's going to cost you to get a flat together?
I know it's going to cost a lot anyway.
About £150. How did you come to be
sorry.
Young, homeless and on the streets?
I used to go to this boarding school in Sussex and it was really horrible, so I decided not to go back one night. And I put my case into the sort of lost property place and I came here. Well, I sort of wandered about a bit, met some friends, and this girl that was at my boarding school, she ran away with me as well. And we came here in the night and slept, and it was really horrible and cold and everything.
What, to Euston?
Yeah. And then
why did you come to Euston?
Well, everybody said it was sort of the place to go and everything, if you was, you know, on the street for a couple of nights, be warm and everything, but it wasn't, it was really cold. And,
You spent your first night in Euston Station?
Yeah, and the next day we went down to the Circle Line to go to sleep, and then we sort of pumped money for something to eat and everything, so I was really hungry because I only had £6, but it seemed to go or nothing. And we went to the music machine that night because I knew that place anyway, and up until 2 o'clock it was wasting time. Then we bought speed and everything to keep awake, and so we wouldn't have to eat or anything, so it was handy. And we just went into the waiting room over there, and we sort of just slept in there, you know, on and off, because you can't sleep properly when you're on that stuff.
Were there many other people sleeping there?
Yeah, a lot of punks and that.
Yeah. And how many nights did you spend sleeping around Euston?
About 3 weeks on and off.
What did you do in between times?
Just walk about, fall asleep places, because we sort of started taking the wrong stuff and we just started blacking out everywhere.
What did you expect to find when you left the boarding school, came to London?
Well, I wanted to get home and I thought this way would be better. I thought, you know, my mum would feel sorry for me and everything. She didn't until I got really ill.
And but what, you had an idea that there might be a bit of fun living rough in London?
Yeah, you know, if you do what you want, there was no sort of laws or anything. But it wasn't like that at all. It's really lonely.
Well, I used to go to King's Cross and I used to sleep rough there, you know, and a lot of goings on went on. But like, the trouble with King's Cross is not as closed up as Euston, yeah. And it's quite open, yeah. And it was quite cold, you know, and sometimes, like, I'd go down into the toilets as well and sit on the toilet, you know, and dress myself up, like, but you see, the toilets were the only poking, they're all small and all. And, and I always used to keep my eyes to the ground open, I'd find money and things like that, you know, because your belly, you know, you just have to survive, you have to learn to survive, that's all. I mean, you realise how far you can go without food, can't you? You can go without food, and you know, I used to ask people if they sell me a cigarette for them. I always just get a penny out, you know, and say, can you sell me a cigarette? And they always just say, oh, you can keep it, you know, keep the money, I'll give you a cigarette, log. And that's the way it used to go on. You just try and learn a little street can, you know, like a street can. You know, that's what you go on. You base yourself on that, and you just survive. You know, when I first come to London, I was quite scared. I was scared in one sense because, like, especially when I seen all the goings on, you know, it was fresh. I knew about it, but when I first seen it, you know, I bet with anybody with a worried mind, I think it could crack them up, and it has done, I guess, to people.
Did you get frightened much?
Yes, because me and my friend, we got really ill, and I had to sort of look after her, and she had to look after me. It was more worry than anything. So I was scared, yeah, I suppose, the first time.
Now, John, when we interviewed you at the hostel, we talked about the fact that you'd been living rough, getting jobs here and there for about 7 years since you ran away from the children's home.
That's right.
We'd like to talk to you a bit about experiences of people that you know who are West End regulars, people who have got into the pattern of living rough in and around the West End over a number of years. Yeah. What about young people who, say, 13-year-old, 14-year-old boys and girls run away from home? I mean, how do they
survive?
Yeah.
Well, you got a lot of them come down here, you know, and they don't last long, you know, because as soon as they're down here, maybe pimp will spot them sort of thing, you know, and take them away and say to them, right, you know, they're cold and they want somewhere to stay and they want food in their stomach, you know, so they'll take them away and promise them it's only a bed for the night. And then usually 9 times out of 10 they'll end up in the rent scene, you know. They take them home and the men maybe probably force them into having sex with them sort of thing, you know. Then they'll meet up with other boys and the boys will tell them, oh, it's easy money, you know, you just go down there and stall and wait for a punter to come, you know. And then they go back with the punter and they get their money and they just keep going on and on and on, you know. A small amount just do it till they have their money so they can go on their way, but a lot of them will stay for quite a few years up here, you know.
And how will they live? What will be the pattern of their lives?
Well, they just, maybe they'll stand in there and...
What time will they go down there?
They're all hours, you know. And they'll wait, they'll get a punter, you know. Well, some will get a punter, they'll get their money, and they'll get into a bed and breakfast for the night, you know, and go to pubs and all that sort of thing. But some will wait for a punter and just stay all night with him. So that's their way of living. They'll get paid off the punter, plus they've got a bed for the night, you know.
Stories have you heard? I mean...
Like, there was this...
What are the dangers?
Well, there's dangers from the police, there's danger from CID. Then you've got... There was a boy up there, last year. He thought himself a hard man, you know. And he used to give out, going to the 13, 14-year-olds. And after the 13-year-olds had went and done their business and get their money, he would go up and take the money off them, you know. And they would get dangers of being sexually abused, really abused, you know. Like, they'll go to somebody's flat, and when they get there, I'll end up, there'll be three guys in there, you know, and they'll have sex with them, you know, and the boys are too scared to say anything, you know, because a lot of the boys that are in, do, are on the game. They don't like being in the game, they just do it because it's their only way of survival, you know.
Because what are the alternatives? Working for £25 a week in a...
Yeah, which is nothing because...
in a restaurant. And you can't live on that in the West End, can you?
You can't live on that in the West End at all. West End's okay if you've got money, but see, if you've no money, it's bad, you know.
Why do the people come here in the first place? Why do those boys come here in the first place?
Well, a lot of people get bored, you know, with their own homes and that, and they'll come up here, you know, expecting to see big lights and all the rest, you know. And West End, to me, is a dump. There's bugger all in the West End, you know.
You got a story about this, it's good. Did you stay here one night?
No, yeah. Stayed here one night, yeah.
But on the bench?
Yeah, I had a long sheepskin then, you know. I used to have a long sheepskin and I slept on the bench. I had people coming up, they'd offer you drinks, didn't they?
Yeah.
The old alcoholics, they offer you drinks.
And cigarettes, didn't they?
Yeah.
And if you had them, you gave them to them as well.
Yeah.
There's a lot of them here, but nice.
Back in a bit.
Yeah, loads of them.
What, you were saying that, how long were you on the streets for?
Long time, since about January on and off.
Where were you sort of in between?
Well, I went home for a couple of times, but it never worked. My mum sort of threw me out, you know. She threw me out.
Yeah.
She threw me out.
Is there some good things about being on the street?
Well, you meet lots of people that are worse off than you. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, you think you're really lucky, but you're not. I mean, you see loads of people around who are really sort of unfortunate.
That comes to that.
What do you do when you've got no money? Nothing, I mean.
I sponsor it all the time.
Right.
Just all the time. It was degrading, yes, but you had to do it. It was a have to. Everybody does it when they're on the streets. You have to survive.
Did that ever get you into trouble? Did you ever get nicked for it or anything?
Oh, warned. They just move you on.
Yeah.
Or you have to fever it even in a shop, you know. See money on the till, just take it and it just comes. It doesn't become as a sort of crime after a while. It's a have to.
Just because you've got to survive.
Yeah, and that's when the trouble starts because you get picked up with it in the end. I never did, I was quite lucky. But, you know, that's the last thing you want is to end up in the nick when you're on the streets.
10 years ago, Centrepoint was set up as a night shelter for homeless young people. It is in the centre of the West End of London, half a mile up Shaftesbury Avenue from Piccadilly. It offers places for up to 30 young people each night, and provides food and shelter from the streets. It opens its gates at 8 o'clock every evening, and the young people leave at 8 o'clock in the morning. They can stay at the shelter for between 3 and 6 nights.
What did you think when you came to the gate?
Well, I was a bit nervous and I thought you wouldn't let me in, you know.
Yeah? And then what did you think when you came in here? Did you expect it to be like this?
Well, you know, they told me at the gate, you know, it wasn't pretty good, you know.
Yeah.
So, I was nervous when I came in.
Yeah.
Still nervous.
Yeah. Settling down a bit there. Yeah. What do you expect to do next?
Well, can't do not tomorrow, but Monday I'll go down to social.
Yeah.
I doubt if I'll get any money, but I can try.
Yeah. Would there be any point in you going home?
No.
Yeah, I haven't got friends in Huddersfield, you could go.
Mm-hmm.
No.
No, nearly all my mates, you know, they're married. I've got families.
Yeah. Right.
Well, our aim is to work with people who are mainly new to London, particularly the younger ones who are at risk in the West End. Basically, we give them a bed for the night, we give them two cooked meals, and advice on how to get whatever they've come to London for.
So an evening starts for them?
Well, an evening starts for them when they come to the gate. We open the gate at 8 o'clock. We interview them at the gate. Two of us go out there, normally. And we would come back in and check our files and then go back and decide who's genuine and who we can actually help. The people we turn away are people who we've known for a long time and we know are messing about. People who are over the age range and government reception centres can cater for. And people we feel really don't need our help. We can't offer them very much. All they want is a bed for the night, which they can get in other places. And they don't really want any advice from us.
Mm. So they come in, you give them a meal?
Yeah, we talk to them. There's one worker on every night with a team of five or six volunteers. The workers rotate and the volunteers do the same night each week. They sit around, have coffee, we chat to them and try and find out a bit about what they're doing. Obviously we can't provide any sort of in-depth counselling service. We see 3,000 kids a year.
What, how do you find the volunteers?
Oh, they're good. You know, they help you out in that if they can. You know, they'll sit and talk to you and ask you your problems and that, you know, and see if we can help you in any way. You know?
So you trust them, really?
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's what it is in here. It's sort of a mutual trust. You know, the staff will trust you so much. Same as you will trust them.
Do you all know Ian? Was he in last weekend?
I think he was in last weekend, but I gave him...
The evening starts for the volunteers with a briefing session, checking through the young people who may return from the previous night. Later on, the volunteers will go through a debriefing to sort out how the young people that came in during the evening can be helped.
So, I think he's quite serious about that. He decided he wouldn't get a casual job today so that he didn't have any money to get drunk on, which is probably quite a good sign. And the maybes, Philip McIntyre will be back if he doesn't get a gyro sent to a friend today. Jose Beloy's a French bloke who's wandering around for some reason. Mary Fuller, in with her sister a couple of weeks ago. She's got 10 sisters and lost them all. Two specifically in London that she's still looking for. She might not be back. She's gone to Shepherd's Bush to look for one of them today. And John Comerford and Francis Hankinson, who I'm sure you'll recognise. I can't place who they are, but they're not John Comerford and Francis Hankinson. One of them's had his hair dyed, and I'm sure if he had black hair I could put a name to him, but I can't. So if they come back, see if you know who they are. And that's it. The rest of the people in last night shouldn't be back. We had a really quiet night last night. So that's a lot.
What do you think about the way that they judge whether you are suitable to be taken in or not? As a person who's been turned away a few times.
Well, a few? You run it in hundreds? Well, I think they really... Right, well, we've got Dean Street, which is a place run by the Department of Health and Social Security. And...
What's that like?
Pretty grim.
Yeah.
No, you're in, you're showered, you're booked, you've got an interview, you're booked in, you watch the telly for a wee while, then it's upstairs to bed, no?
Yeah.
And Christ, the dormitories are ridiculous.
Yeah.
Granted, the dormitories are clean. It is pretty, you know,
humiliating.
Morbid. Yeah. This place is pretty informal, you know.
Yeah.
There's no... Sort of, you will do this. It's a question that comes up and saying, listen, listen Ian, could you go and do such and such a thing for us?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could tell me to say, go and stuff it.
Yeah.
But, you know, people respect that they've been treated as people, not like animals.
Yeah. Fair enough, I've came and been knocked back.
I've been in here a lot longer than a lot of other people at times,
you know, but I'd still, if I really, I'd rather when I feel myself can do hell again, I'd come back here, you know, and try, you know.
Yeah, right.
Well, it's just like being in with a crowd of folk that you can really get in, because, like I said, most of them's much the same age group, and you've got the habit of, you're maybe meeting folk from places you've already been, and it's not like coming in, everybody's in the same boat kind of thing. Maybe if they've got cigarettes, you don't. It's, you know, everything's shared, you know.
Where are you from?
I'm Australian.
Yeah.
But I think that's why I like to come here, because without family, also in relations, or a lot of really good friends, I like to have some part of me is necessary to be given to somebody else, and I sort of get that out of this place and really enjoy it. It's nice to be needed by somebody, you know.
Yeah.
But I don't have a problem talking to people. They don't seem to, I mean, I mustn't sort of stand here and look like, you know, don't go over to her, she'll sort of, you know. they just open up, you don't have any problem, you know, it's quite easy.
Yeah.
You don't even think about it. I think that's the best way, just sort of act naturally and they just chat to you.
What do you normally do during the day?
Well, I teach part-time acting, really, at a theatre school. So I'm able to do this because I have a fair amount of time on my hands at the moment, so it's not too much trouble to come in one evening a week.
Right. And so what do you get out of it?
Well, I find it's interesting. You meet all sorts of different people from different areas with different problems, and I enjoy chatting to them and on a level, and helping them with, you know, any advice that I can give. But I think just meeting them is interesting.
And so what do you get out of volunteering at Centrepoint? Why does it appeal to you?
Meeting people, helping people.
Oh, yeah.
Whenever I can.
I suppose the reason I wanted to do something for homeless kids is because I feel there, but for the grace of God, go my kids.
Yeah.
And I would like to think that somebody would have done something to help them if they'd been in the same situation.
What are the sort of skills you think you need for volunteering in a night refuge like Centrepoint?
Need to listen, I think, more than anything else. And to never judge them. I mean, you know, no matter why they're in that situation, they're in it, and they need someone to talk to.
No, don't work in the bakery. But it's the only job I can get.
It isn't, you see. You can do a lot of other things.
Like what?
Well, you could work
factory.
Yes, or in a cafe. You could work in a pub. You could go as a filing girl to some office.
What? No, I don't want to work in an office.
Well, you could.
God.
You don't want to work in an office?
No, God, no.
Well, it's a lot less strain, isn't it?
I don't just sit inside all day.
No, all right. Well, there are a lot of things you can do.
Yeah.
What have you been doing up till now?
Bakery work.
All the time?
In the Kentucky, fried chicken for 1.5 days.
Did you enjoy that?
No, I've walked out. Because they all went down the pub, so I went down. I've seen them all going past, so I went down. I just walked out, because it was on Friday.
Did you take some fried chickens with you?
I ate what I wanted, then I went out. But it's working on Friday nights and Saturday nights. I couldn't stand it.
Yeah. When everybody else is free. Well, that's the advantage of an office, you see. You finish at 5 o'clock on a Friday. And
9 to 5 every day.
Right.
And
yes.
Yeah.
Saturday and Sunday off.
Can you imagine me getting an office
Sorry.
Job? Hair like this.
Oh, yes, you could do.
Do you reckon?
I think so.
Oh, I don't.
Then we all sit around and discuss each client and write down the card, fill out the cards with all the information we've gleaned from the evening. And, you know, the worker sort of takes it all down. We've got a special book, we write all the details in, how many nights they've been in the particular months, and whether they'll be readmitted the next night.
Cliff Eaton, oh, well, he's the month's success story, isn't he?
Which one is he?
He's the one with went off for a day's casual at the BBC.
Oh,
they offered
yes.
him a full-time job.
Yes.
He's going to come back tomorrow. If he can't get a sub on Monday, he'll take an A7 in. And get a week in hand money off Social Security.
Yeah, he was absolutely delighted that he'd actually worked all day, hasn't he?
Yeah.
As opposed to...
He's going to go round to New Horizon tomorrow. They might have some more ideas on accommodation. But he's got the bed and breakfast list anyway. Ade Lawal, oh dear. He's the one that came in late. And I really don't know what he's playing at. He said his parents threw him out. He gave me the home phone number and there's nobody there. But he said that last night and he was going to sort it out today and now he's going to sort it out tomorrow.
He's quite smart. He hasn't been sleeping.
Yeah, I think he's messing about. I'm not sure what he's doing. I don't believe a word of what he's saying.
He knows that.
I'll have a chat to him in the morning. Tony Clark. Do you want to go?
Oh, yeah, yeah. He lived with his mother and she died not too long ago. And he lived for, he went to stay for a time with some friends and this didn't work out. He couldn't keep up the payments on the council flat, so he got rid of the furniture and got himself enough money to come down here. He's a welder and he's quite confident that he'll get a job pretty shortly doing just that. He seems to be very keen to get work, but he also thinks that he's going to get a flat, you know, with the first week's money.
Where's his father?
His father died about 8 years ago. Or no, more than that, I think, actually.
I didn't realise all these numbers hadn't been put in.
Does that mean you've got all the numbers wrong?
Yeah, they're all
right. Oh, great.
Not to worry.
Yeah, it's not because he's a dreamer, it's just he doesn't know.
Yeah, if we point out a few realities without dampening his enthusiasm, I think he'll be all right.
The house?
No room if Steve gets in.
Another house?
Yes, we could do with another 10 houses, but we haven't got them.
He's just the sort of house he's for, really.
Yeah.
I would have thought.
Well, maybe there'll be room.
Because he is somebody who's left the shelter of the parental home with no fault of his own. You know, he's just collapsed around him.
Bembo?
Yes.
Brother Anthony would love him. Well, yeah, I'll get Peter to talk to him about Bembo Base maybe tomorrow then. Because he does need somewhere a bit sheltered for a bit then, by the sound of it, doesn't he? Jane Hansen, you were talking to her, weren't you, Colin?
Oh, yes. Now, she's had a row with her parents. Or rather her father more than her parent. She had a job in a pub that catered for the bikers, see, motorbike people. And her father didn't agree with that. She started going out with a boy she met at the pub. Her father didn't mind the boy very much, but he did object to the hours that she was keeping. And they had a classic row and she said, right, I'm going to London. She's packed her bags. She's worked as a barmaid. I thought she was very together. I was surprised when all this came out about her going, you know, following the bikers and all this, but she's spent a lot of time in hospital because she fell off somebody's bike and smashed her leg and she was months and months in hospital.
She's
very frightened, but I think this may be the shakes after the row with the parents. I think it could be a reaction. Because there's nothing in here to frighten her. I wouldn't have thought.
No. She's teamed up with Derek Dobby, which I don't know whether that's a very good idea, but still. He's going to show her where New Horizon is tomorrow. And she knows a Loan in London service because a friend of hers came down and they fixed everything up for her, so she says. And she's going to go up and see them on Monday. I reckon if she goes up there on Monday, they'll probably persuade her to go home. I think by that time she won't need much persuading. Because her mother's okay, isn't she? It's the father she's argued with. So I think. Who's going?
Don't
really. No. Yeah. I'll go. Do you want the gate sheet? Yeah, I think by Monday she might decide that the best idea is to go home. But if she doesn't, then she can go up to ours and sort out. She's been signing on in Huddersfield, so she should be able to sign on okay down here. Unless they're for a travel warrant, but give her tomorrow to find a way around a bit and see what she thinks tomorrow night, I think.
And what will the kids that you know who are out on the streets who haven't managed to get in tonight, what will they be doing?
The car park.
The car park.
What's it like down there?
It's warm and it's out of the rain. That is about it.
Yeah. But they can go all hassle with old Bill, you know?
The law. Take a grim view on it.
And it's awful hard to keep yourself clean when you're sleeping in the car park.
You've been working here now for 2 days and two nights, more or less solidly. How do you feel after that?
Shattered. I think the feeling at the end of the night when the gate slams behind them and you put the last tick in the book, it's very satisfying in a way. You've got through another night and nothing disastrous has happened. That's satisfying, but you know, at the end of it, you're shattered.
Yeah. What do you think about your conditions of work here? The support that you get?
I think I get an enormous amount of support, both from the volunteers and from the rest of my team, full-time workers. I think that support has to be there because we're working under enormous pressure for very long hours. I think we back each other's judgment very much. We trust each other, and there is a lot of support.
So the night refuge is under pressure?
Oh, very much under pressure, yes. I think at the moment we're finding that we are giving kids very much a minimum of advice in a lot of cases. What we can do, of course, is get them off the streets for the night. The West End is not a very safe place for young kids. There's a lot of drugs, prostitution. We try and take them out of that before they get involved in it. And we can send them on to other projects that have got more time to give them advice. And whose advice we would rely on.
Yeah, so you've got a close relationship with other projects?
We have a close relationship with several other projects in the West End who are advice places. They will help with problems with social workers or social security, immigration officers, and help them to find accommodation. But it's very little. Yeah. And if you're down to the level of asking to come in here, then I think you need more than just a job. But it's very difficult to offer them really what they need. Mm. Our hostel has 12 beds. We see 3,000 kids. And if you start playing the numbers game, I think you just get so depressed you pack up and go home. So we try not to think about it, I suppose. It's appalling that our 10th anniversary is coming up next month. And we were set up as a stopgap measure 10 years ago. And nothing has been done. We're just seeing more and more and more people. And all the signs are that the statutory services will cut back and we will carry on seeing more and more people. I find that appalling in this country.
In 1979, Centrepoint received more than 12,000 requests for emergency accommodation for young people to come into its night shelter. We took in over 7,500 of those, so you can see that we had to turn away quite a few of them. Many of them came from all over the country, and unfortunately a lot of them were dumped at our doorstep by the social institutions, the prisons, the hospitals, and even the social services. I was just looking through one of Centrepoint's earlier annual reports, and it's quite clear to me that absolutely nothing has changed for these homeless youngsters. All that we can offer at Centrepoint's night shelter is a very short-term solution, a few nights' space. A kind of sticking plaster, but no more. So, to give some of these youngsters a better chance, we opened up a short-term hostel in the west of London, in Hammersmith, where up to 12 young people can stay in safety and security for up to 6 months. We're also working on a couple of bed-sit schemes where some of the luckier ones will be able to have their own bed sits or flats at a price that they can afford. The paradox of all this is that Centrepoint itself is in a very vulnerable financial position. And we never know from 1 year to the next whether we are going to survive ourselves. And it's absolutely vital that we do. For many hundreds of young people, Centrepoint has become the place of last resort. And if we are to give them a chance, a new start in life, then it's absolutely vital that we survive ourselves.
Glass?
Yeah.
With the people sleeping there, yeah?
Yeah. Oh. Oh. That way. Oh.
Here we are on Euston Station, and it's 4 o'clock in the morning. What are you doing here at this time of the morning?
Well, a lot of my mates are waiting for a train, and they're more likely to go home. But I, unfortunately, I'm homeless at the moment.
How long have you been homeless?
Last 2 months.
2 months. So you've just been sleeping here and there on the west end?
Well, yeah, no, not, well, I slept twice in a place called Centrepoint.
Yeah.
And other times I've been staying with mates. And I've done a bit of squatting. And then I managed to get myself a job out of place. But then I lost the job and I lost the place. And it's just, well, it's just roughly been the last 2 months that's been a bit unfortunate.
Yeah. So what do you think you're going to be able to do in the future about getting yourself a place?
Well, it's, you know, it's funds really. I mean, it's mainly finding a job, but being homeless, you know, you find it hard because you don't have sufficient sleep. And it's very hard to keep jobs, so you're mainly doing casual jobs, but they don't pay a lot. They pay a little bit, but, you know, sort of enough to get your food and stuff like that. But otherwise, if I come in luck with some money or something, then I'll be able to get myself a place.
What's it like for actually finding a place, even if you had the money to do it?
Bloody terrible. Well, it's, you know, it's okay if you got enough for about, say, 4 weeks in advance, plus the key money, plus a few other things, and then getting yourself set up. And, you know, it's pretty difficult, and not yet, well, being a rocker in it, you know, the landlord will tend to take a look at you and thinks, sod that, you know, I'm not having him here because he's trouble. And it's also finding a job because you go for an interview and they see the way you're dressed. They don't take you as your person, they take you the way you're dressed. And, you know, you're sort of social outcast just because you wear a leather jacket.
Yeah.
And
it doesn't mean to say you beat up old ladies.
No. No, I might love to be. No, but...
Yeah.
You know, I mean... Really, I mean... Most of us, we're on the right side of law, but because of the law, the way they act, they see someone they think is acting suspicious, you get hassled by the police because they come, they ask you questions, they accuse you of things, they call you names, and before you know it, you are up in court. And when you go to court, because having no fixed abode, they slam you inside, and once you're inside, well, you may as well give up, you know? So yeah. It goes. And then they give you a probation officer, but I mean, probation officers are there. They say to help, but they don't bloody help. All they do is sort of sit and chat to you and get their money at the end of the week, you know.
Yeah. So if, living rough and sleeping in places like Euston and that, do you think you get moved on a lot?
Yeah. Well, I mean, say, you know, you just come in here more or less to keep warm, yeah?
Mm.
You sit down, a copper will come along here, turn around and say, have you got a ticket? Of course you haven't got a bloody ticket, you know, and you say, would you mind leaving the station because you think you're going to cause a nuisance? And then, I mean, you're forced back out on the street, you walk down the street, a cop says, what are you doing out this time of the morning? You know, and he turns around and says, well, go and sit in the station. So you're more or less walking from A to B all the bloody time, you know.
So what do you do to get a bit of sleep,
usually, I more or less go on a circle line, and you just go around in circles all day and go to sleep. As long as your daily commutes don't disturb me.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't cause people hassle or nothing like that. I'm just an unfortunate, really. That's all.